Welcome to this webcast, which will introduce two case studies on the implementation of feed-in tariff in developed countries. Two countries are Germany and the UK. In Germany, the electricity market is extremely fragmented, and it took a long time to build a consensus around renewable energy technology. In 1979, tariff system has been introduced, but with no standard contract. Decentralized generation was blocked in the 1980s by energy companies and landowner ministries, and the regulation, which dated from 1935, did not allow for any competition. The first feed-in tariff has been introduced in 1990, and this is because of Chernobyl in 1986, which stopped nuclear expansion, because also of the recognition of climate change as a very important environmental issue by Helmut Kohl, and also because of a success of a small program of 100 megawatt wind and 1,000 solar roofs, which was launched in 1988. The initial bill for the feed-in tariff was just to support small hydro, but the nascent wind industry got involved. And so, finally, it included small hydro plus wind. It got the support from MPs from all parties, and the law was used at that time to have just a minor impact, so was not perceived as a threat by electric utilities. And so, it was finally adopted. Since then, there has been a number of feed-in tariff laws. The first one, so in 1990, was a feed-in system based on market price, topped by premium payment, and with the liberalization of the market in 1992, price went down, so tariff for renewable went down also, so the law has been replaced by a fixed rate for renewable in 2000. And since then, there has been a constant revision and adjustment of feed-in tariff in Germany. Germany, it's a success story. As you can see on this graph, the share of renewable went from 6% in 2000 to 16%, over 16% in 2010. So targets are extremely ambitious. 35% of renewable in 2020, 80% in 2050, and maybe even more since Fukushima, Germany wants to get rid of its nuclear plant. Now, a contrasted case, completely different, the one from the UK. In the UK, there has been a marginal support for renewable, and this is maybe linked to the lack of feed-in tariff. In the UK, the government has opted for a non-fossil fuel obligation in 1990, which was a tender scheme, which was a way to subsidize the nuclear industry and as a byproduct to support renewable energy. Then this has been replaced by a quota system called ROC, Renewable Obligation Certificate. And this was an obligation for utility to buy a share of generation from renewable. It's a system which favors established players and tend to exclude small developers because there is no guarantee on the tariff, and so there is a very high risk for newcomers on the electricity market. For a long time, the government in the UK has been locked in the ideology of competition and didn't want to set prices. And a feed-in tariff has been adopted only very recently, in 2010, and only for small-scale renewable under 5 megawatts. There are a number of actors, as you can see on this table, which are involved in the definition of the renewable energy policy. The traditional one in black, the opponents in red, and the proponents in green. This is the feed-in tariff in the UK, and as you can see, it has been revised already, and its duration is up to 25 years, so for a number of technology, hydro, solar PV, wind, and anaerobic digestion. Some lessons from the two case studies and other OECD countries. Well, feed-in tariffs are extremely successful in enlarging the market and raising cost of renewable energy down. They are always the result of a long process of negotiation, which involves a number of actors from different segments of the society. And this is needed to build a long-term commitment to renewable energy. And third lesson, adjustment and revision need to be done regularly while guaranteeing investors long-term benefits.